Well, I'd like to welcome you to the One Word Now broadcast. I'm Pastor Dr. Darren Goodman, and for the next 45 minutes, I believe the message that I'm going to teach you or the instruction I can give you has the power to change your life. Like I said, it has the power to change your life. The question is, will we receive the Word with its power and allow it to change us? Amen. I believe we do. So just turn to the person next to you and say, hey, let it change you. Since I'll just say, let it change you. Amen. It will change me. Amen. And we'd also like to welcome all the way from China, which city? Shanghai, China. God bless you. We're glad that you're here with us. Yes? You translate? Can you translate? She's looking for us to translate. Don't want me to do that. And so please feel welcome while you're here. Yes. Yes. Feel welcome. Amen. Bless you. Yes. Amen. It's amazing. When Drup and I started, our first sanctuary was our bedroom. I first started to speak and prophesy in our bedroom when we would pray before we'd go to sleep at night. That eventually turned from mere praying to prophesying and speaking things that I didn't understand. Things that we would see in our future that would become our life. And it seemed so far out there then. But I'll never forget, Drup started to write things down in a journal. And what we started to see was what God had told us in the bedroom. Months and years later, he would fulfill publicly. Our ministry started in that bedroom, and this ministry has been maintained in that bedroom. Now me is kind of in the shower. I pray a lot in the shower. But I'm here to tell you, you have to have a place where you connect with God. If you're expecting him to do something great in your life, you have to have a place where you can go and receive from him. Now, I don't believe that has to be a far out location. I believe that needs to be time in your day and also a place where you can get away. And your home is a good place. You know, your home is a place where God wants to meet you and God wants to be the Lord of your home. And I remember many times I would prophesy things and they would just fly out of my mouth. And my mind tried to catch up with what just flew out my mouth. You ever have that problem? Sometimes you say something, it's like, what did I just say? I shouldn't have said it. Or in a good sense, I said something I don't fully understand. Well, that's how our ministry started, is I would speak prophetically, and I didn't have any clue what I was speaking out. I would just allow God to totally use me. And that was in the privacy of our home. Publicly, I was helping in our church we attended. I was in a church that didn't believe God still moved today or spoke to people today. They were of the opinion that God had said everything he needed to say to the apostles when they put together the Bible. And that's hard for me to imagine. The God that spoke the entire universe into existence, when he sat down, he just shut up? I don't think so. I believe God's still speaking. Amen. And so that's how we began. And I'll never forget, from the infant stage, we would speak of nations. Nation after nation that would experience the love of God and be inspired by the precious Holy Spirit. And we've lived to be able to see that. And so I'm always blessed when people come and visit from around the world. I'm always blessed. I love China. And I can't wait till I get to go there and meet others that love Jesus and meet people that don't know him, so I can tell them of him. I cannot wait. I just received an invitation that I hold so precious to Pakistan. Connection of our ministry, a couple. They are doing great crusades in Pakistan. And people by the thousands are being saved in their meeting. As far as your eye can see is bodies. People standing and ready to receive Jesus. They invited me this week, next year, to their revival meeting. I don't know what they call it. It's a big revival. Praise God. And so I was excited. I said, well, sure, certainly I'll go. You know, and I cannot wait. Because the women wear silks from India, their clothes. It's so beautiful. They have flowers everywhere. Silks and all types of linens on the platform and around throughout the, if they're in a tent or if it's an open-air crusade like this last one, but it's still everywhere. It's so beautiful, friends. Sometimes we get so caught up in our everyday living that we fail to realize God created a big world. God has people everywhere. God's reaching throughout the nations, and he's lifting people up and bringing them close to him. And I don't know about you, but that's what I want to be a part of more than anything. It goes so beyond building buildings. It goes so beyond television and the things that we do for the ministry. It's all about connecting God's people, his creation, back to him through Jesus Christ. And that has to be our forethought every day. And I believe if that is the center focal point of our faith and walk with Christ, I believe he will add to us in many ways. He'll add to us peace and joy. He'll give us contentment. He'll give us satisfaction and assurance. He'll also give us insight about our future. And he'll certainly add success to you and well-being in your physical body. Amen. I believe it's a completed work. Say this, I have everything in Christ. I am amply supplied. Amen. And that is what God does, is he amply supplies us. Today I want to talk to you about faith's open door. Faith's open door. And as I start, I want you to understand that we do comprehend this thing called faith. Now, in our culture, when I talk faith, many times we're thinking of the aspect of what religion do you ascribe to? And that is one aspect of the term faith. But there's more than that. And that would be this measure of faith, which is a substance that God utilizes and has given to man, a measure of faith. And out of that measure, it can be developed through the studying of the word and through applying it for daily living. And as you apply this thing called faith, it begins to produce the desires of your heart. God wants to give you the desires of your heart. Jesus said, when you pray, ask of the Father in my name, and he will do it. Amen? That's what he said. And so I have to take Jesus at his very words. These aren't Darren's words. These are Jesus Christ's words. And you can see that in Scripture. And he asked, or he said, when you pray, ask of the Father those things that you desire, and he will give them to you. This is the tapestry that we have between that was given to us, our model that was given to us by Jesus so that we can connect with God, our Heavenly Father. Amen? And I believe Jesus got it right. Because if God is the Father, in essence a Father, then I would believe he's the best or the perfect Father. I believe there's probably no one as good as him as a Father, right? And how many of you know that your Father wants to give you what you want or desire? Amen? Right? If you're ever hanging out with your dad and he goes, what do you want to eat? You go, oh man, I want to, you know, McDonald's cheeseburger. Well, he didn't take you over and get you an organic salad, did he? He gave you the desire of your heart. He probably should have given you that organic salad, but think about it. Whenever grandpa says to you, hey, you want to go get an ice cream? You go, oh yeah, grandpa, let's go get an ice cream. Well, he didn't take you somewhere else and get you a cup of black coffee. No, he didn't. See, they tried to meet the desire or request. The same as with God. The Bible says, make your requests known unto God. See, So when we ask or request things, Scripture lays it out very clear that there is a pathway of how to ask, and we should ask. And all of that comes through thanksgiving. Amen? Praise God. So back to this measure of faith. We've heard of a measure of faith. We've heard of a spirit of faith. But today I'm going to talk about a door of faith. And for you to understand a door of faith, you've got to know that faith is a substance of things hoped for. The evidence of things not revealed yet to you or your senses. So if faith is a substance of things hoped for, then faith, when we talk of a door, is a substance creating the door that you're hoping for. Hello? Let me say it like this. Faith, or this door of faith, is an ascribed place that God has already assigned. And you have to find it by faith. And when you approach this by faith, there is a day this door swings wide open to you. The door of faith. Now, what is that? Let's put it like this. A door of opportunity. Let me kick it up a notch. What is that? A prescribed door of the Heavenly Father that you're assigned to walk through. And when you walk through it, you'll walk through it full of God's grace, full of His ability, full of His fresh anointing, so you can be most effective on the other side of the door. Amen? A door of faith. Catherine Kuhlman used to take the platform. She understood how to walk through a door of faith. What'd she do? Whatever God told her to. She got people healed. She delivered His word. She showed people that God is a touchable God. Benny Hinn, when he steps through his door of faith, people get healed all over the building. Billy Graham, when he would walk through an ascribed door of faith, everybody would get saved. Do you hear me? We often think it's the anointing, but I believe that there's this place and time that you can step into where the supernatural becomes the norm, a manifestation. I believe when you walk through that door of faith, it's not based on prayer of faith. It's a door of faith. Just like that's a door and that's a light. Two different things. And when you walk through a door of faith, it opens up. And I'm telling you, it's quantum leap physics. God starts to perform the miraculous, and you feel so small and insignificant in its wake or in its path. Do you hear me? A door of faith. When Solomon, or Samson, had to ward off an army, and he picks up the jawbone of a donkey, I believe there was a door of faith materializing. What? The supernatural met his natural. And he did something way beyond man's comprehension, even by today's standards. Do you hear me? Amen? A door of faith. Now, that may materialize, and as you know, not every door looks the same. You know, I woke up this morning at 5 o'clock looking at my closet doors. Actually, it was my daughter's room. I sleep and went from the couch where I'd fallen asleep to, I knew I'd wake Drup up because I tend to moan and groan before the Lord. Some call that snoring. I've still not convinced her yet it's spiritual. Anyways, and so I was sleeping in my daughter's room. So I woke up like 3 or 4 and I thought, well, I'll just go and lay down. I fell asleep, I wake up, and I'm looking at the closet door. And as I look at the closet door, I don't know if your doors are like mine, but in the middle of the closet doors were a cross. There's two of them. And when they're together properly, like every teenager's bedroom should be, clean, right? When they're together properly, there's a third cross. It's amazing to me. So I'm looking at the three crosses on a wall, 4 o'clock this morning. And I'm thinking, oh Lord, the symbol of Christ's cross is all over the world. Not just in a religious context. It's everywhere. It's became an engineer structure, if you will, or icon of structure in engineering. It's used everywhere and in design. It's magnificent. Do you hear me? And so as I'm looking at this cross, I'm thinking, good Lord, You're everywhere. Then I got to think, what door in my house doesn't have it? None of them. They all have it. In the center, if you go home and look, if you have a panel door, there's a cross. So if real spiritual people come to your house and they go, oh, I don't see no pictures of Jesus. You say, no, every door is a cross in my house. Right? So what am I saying? Not every door looks alike. In this building, we have glass doors and wooden doors. And we have one back there that's a door without a door. Right? Come on. So there's many types of doors that you'll encounter in this path and in this journey as you serve the Lord. And can I tell you, just as there's different doors, all of them are accessed by one thing called faith. Now, some doors need a key, right? Some doors you just step on a pad and it opens. I like those. It's kind of like Star Trek level. Right? Wouldn't you like to have a house where you just walk through a door, it opens, and it closes and back you? I'd like that. I would. I'd like that. I'd like a toilet like that. You get close to it, it just opens up. You leave it, it shuts. That's cool, huh? Amen. Refrigerator openeth, and it just opens and it shuts. So some doors need a key, and we're going to discover this also. But there's a door of faith, just like a spirit of faith. And I believe when we embark on a door of faith, there's nothing in hell that can stop you. Amen. You'll experience God's grace. You'll experience God's favor. You'll experience the Holy Spirit and its ability working through you. And when you go through that door of faith, nothing can stop you. Amen. Not one thing will impede your progress. It will try, but it will not succeed. Now, with that being said, let's go to Acts chapter 14, verse 16. Is this good so far? Amen. Are you enjoying today? Is she enjoying today? Amen. Good. Good. Watch this. Acts chapter 14, verse 16. And from there, speaking of Paul, they sailed to Antioch, from where they had been recommended to the grace of God for the work which they fulfilled. Look at the word recommended. You know, God never demands you to do anything. He recommends. It's sometimes hard for us to understand and imagine that God's such a gentleman. Because we've been taught that he's a taskmaster, a slave driver, and he's not. It's so easy to follow Holy Spirit. You don't need to pray forever. You just need to be willing and obedient. And Holy Spirit says, follow me. And he steps in a direction. And what do? Follow. It doesn't matter if you shake. Doesn't matter if you jump up and down. No, when Holy Spirit says, follow me, you just follow. That's how simple it is to be obedient to God. It's simple. I was taught for years it was hard. It is not. It's so easy to follow God, sometimes I think we mess it up. Sometimes I think in all the reading we do, we get too much information. It's so simple to follow God. Matter of fact, can I just give you a little insight? The less I study other men's works about the Bible, the better revelation I get from God. Do you hear me? And sometimes I think we get so educated just in our natural mind that we can actually prevent the revelation of Holy Spirit in our lives. Amen? So, and I'm not against studying. I believe we should. But we have to have a good balance. So it goes on to say, where they had been recommended to the grace of God for the work which they had fulfilled. Now watch this, verse 17. And having arrived, I wish some people would arrive. I'm so tired of them being on a hamster wheel, spinning their wheels. I'm so tired of them hearing about how they always miss it. I'd just like to smack them on the head, maybe they'll get it. You know? Have you guys ever had an instrument that didn't work on your car or tractor or airplane or boat? What do? You tap it. All of a sudden, it's just ting, it comes online. Maybe some Christians just need a good hard tap on the head. Amen? I know God's done that to me several times. Look at this. And having arrived, watch, and gathering the church, they related all that God had done with them and how he had opened the door of faith to the nations. How wide is your door of faith? Is it just big enough for you to squeeze through and maybe a family member? Are you believing God for a door of faith that all nations can be ushered through? See, Paul's vision was way beyond just himself. Listen to me, North American Christians. We must have an insight and a revelation that goes beyond just us getting saved. You are saved. Now what are you going to do with the rest of the 50 years you got to live? Why don't we believe for a door that's big enough for others to walk through or nations to come through? And this is the kind of faith Paul had. Yes, he had the encounter with Christ and then received a mandate. And from then on, his purpose was to go to nations with the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen? I'm so ingrained in that. I can't see anything other than that. When I sit with other pastors and have the faith that I just want to build a building and live out my years pastoring that building, I can't. It's like they're speaking a different language to me. I don't see it that way. I see it as we are restored and renewed, then we get inspired, and in our inspiration, God starts to send us. And as we send, we build the family of God. Amen? Multiple locations. God is the best McDonald's you'll ever see, or Starbucks. He wants to be everywhere all the time because he's omnipresent. And sometimes we want to isolate him just to our family, our region, our little church, our little whatever corner on the globe. God's bigger than that. So don't limit him. Don't limit him. And maybe it's fear people deal with. So you can't be in faith and fear simultaneously. You'll never embark on a door of faith if you're abiding in fear. If you live by fear and your senses instead of living by faith and not by sight, you'll never accomplish anything for God. Because this journey is not based on what you see, what you feel, how you feel. It's based on faith and what is not visible just yet. It's a walk of faith. It's a living by faith. It's a doing by faith. And it's a knowing by faith. Does that make sense? I'm starting to preach this out. This is getting good to me. We're only on my first passage. Amen? Look at this. So they arrived. And here's something that we need as mature believers. We need to get to a point where we have arrived. Not prideful, not boastful in self, but arrived in knowing the Word and knowing how God functions so that we can function. Amen? Sometimes we're always learning, always studying, never getting anything. Let us always learn, always study, and be fruitful. Amen? Instead of flaky. Praise God. Look at this. The Holy Spirit will direct us and God will grace us. That's the key. Holy Spirit directs, God graces. I don't mean to be yelling, but I'm excited right now. Amen? This place needs to be a pavilion. Look at this. God wants the work accomplished just as bad as we desire to be used of God and have success by God. He wants us to get it accomplished. Does that make sense? Amen? All Christians have a desire to be used of the Lord. I really believe that. All of them have good ambition to help God in the earth. I really believe that. I believe that's authentic. But God also wants us to accomplish the work, meaning get it done. Whatever the assignment, move forward in it. Amen? Get it accomplished. Why? Because that speaks of Him and how He's so willing to help and to reach people. Amen. Just say amen. Just say it one more time. Amen. That's good news to us. Amen? Amen. Amen? Amen. Amen? Amen. Amen? Amen. I was with a friend in a car the other day, and we were driving, and we were talking different churchy things. And we pulled up to a stoplight, and I looked over, and somebody had put on a box, amen, in letters. And he had made a statement. I looked this way. I went, amen. And he restated it again. I went, amen. He restated it again. I went, amen. He goes, why aren't you looking at me? I go, Craig, because I'm looking at that sign right there. It says amen. He's like, dude. You're crazy. Amen. Look at this. Paul's first initiative was gathering the church after he came to Antioch. Look at that. Do you see the apostolic heart? It's to get God's people together, not divide them, not to ostracize them. It's to gather them up. It's to bring them close. It's to get them in the flow, if you will. Get them in the mix, we would say. And watch what he shares with them. It says in that verse 17, and they gathered the church. They related. Don't we need to be relatable now? All that God had done. Not all the workings of the devil. Big difference. The church's purpose is to tell people what God has done and is doing, so they'll understand He will for them as well. Amen? And this is what Paul was doing. Wherever he went, he would go to the synagogues if they would receive him, to the church people, the believers, and if they wouldn't receive him, he went to the streets. So that's a threefold ministry. To the synagogues, to the churches, and to the streets. Amen? And if the streets don't receive you, oh well, just get in a ship and go somewhere else. Just board Princess Cruise Line. Amen? Notice this. He wasn't sharing his troubles. He was sharing his triumphs. He was inspiring, not firing. He was inspiring, not firing. Put this in your notes. Being Spirit-led is recognizing the direction of the Holy Spirit for the purpose of God's will to be accomplished through our lives. When we say we're Spirit-led, that doesn't mean we just talk in tongues. I know some think that's the extent of it. Or we can shake. I've had all that. I've had God, the Spirit of God come upon me. I just knocked me on my butt. I've had it. Literally, I felt like it took the breath out of me. Power of God one time hit me when I was preaching. The only thing I could see was my hand like this as I started to prophesy. The next thing I saw is I felt like I went back. I hit a big speaker, knocked it over, and my finger was still pointed at the ceiling. And I was blown out. Had no idea. God had just like hit me. And I'm telling you, I don't even know what I got. All I know is I liked it. It was good. You know, it was fun. And I can tell you this. God is that and more. I've been in the presence of God where it was so strong, I couldn't walk. I had to crawl. I've been in the presence of God where I couldn't even crawl. It was the atmosphere was so charged with God's presence that the atmosphere became weighty, if that makes sense to you. Where like the atmospheric pressure was so intensified, I couldn't even lift myself up. I could just lay there. I've been in the presence of God to such an extent, at times, I couldn't even utter words. All I could do is just cry and groan from the depths of my belly. And all of that is good. But all of that is for naught if when I get up, I don't have a changed heart and a fresh inspiration to live for the Lord Jesus Christ and be a light. Amen? So all of our spiritual encounters let us have a purpose on the outset, which is to be a light, to be a connector, to be a helper, amen, instead of a hindrance and a hinderer. Does that make sense? Say, that's good teaching. Now look at this. Go with me to Colossians 4:3. Speaking of Paul and the apostles' work, look at what Colossians says. Praying together about us also. When it says praying together, what does that mean? They were together praying collectively as a group. But more than just them being there, they were in agreement. You know, your prayers will be answered when, if you're connected with others and you're praying with others, when you're praying the same thing, wanting the same outcome. That's collective faith then. That's corporate anointing. That's always better than individual if you can get that unison or that unity. Does that make sense? So praying together, look at this. What do you think they're praying about? They're probably praying about the will of God and the direction to go in. Amen? Praying together about us that God may open to us a door of the word. Now, I've talked to you about a door of faith. This is a door of the word. Turn to your neighbor and say, man, there's many doors. And in the 60s, you wonder why a band came out called The Doors. Maybe they were reading the Bible before they got on LSD. I don't know. But look at this. This is three doors down. I like that one. Yes. God may open to us a door of the Word. Do you know there's things in the Word of God that your natural mind can read and get a hold of? There's other things that your natural mind misses. But when God opens the door of the Word, revelation out of Scripture comes. Something not seen before. Something locked up before. And all of a sudden it starts to make sense to you. I study about the human mind often. And one of them I like is a show where they talk about magic and illusions. And they're talking, it's called Brain Games. And they talk about how the human mind works and how magicians, entertainers, utilize the understanding of the human mind to entertain people. And we call that magic, right? Or illusionists. The human mind is only able to, it records a lot, but the articulation after the recording is the key. So there's a lot of information being taken in, but the articulation or to intellectualize what has been received is where we fall very short. For example, if I would ask you, if you saw the purple car out in the parking lot when you came here to church today, you'd go, no, I didn't see it. But if you walked out there, it may be out there. I hope there's a purple car out there right now. That's just a metaphor. But through sleight of hand, see, through diversion. You ever see the shell trick where they have three shells and a ball? And you bet on which one it's going to be in, and the guy goes like this, and then you think you know where the ball is. And then he turns over the shell, and it's like, it's not there. And it's on his nose. No, and then it's in another shell, right? What is it? It's the human mind can be blocked and distracted. And the illusionist knows how the brain works, and he uses that as his scheme. Let me present this to you. The enemy is using many schemes in this life to distract us, to keep us off of revelation. Because if we get revelation of who Christ is and who we are in Him, this whole world would get saved. All types of things would change. Our governments would change. People's needs would change. There would be great outpourings. There'd be great healings, great manifestations of God. And more importantly, we would accomplish great and awesome things for the glory of God. But the enemy knows how the human mind works, and he uses schemes to keep us tracking or trekking down dead-end streets. Does that make sense? So when the door of the Word opens, what happens is your human mind connects with the Spirit of God within you, and all of a sudden, revelation comes. And the door of the Word opens to you. And it makes so much sense. Now, watch this. When you know it's an authentic revelation, it's when you can articulate it to someone else and they get it. I've had people come up to, oh, God gave me a revelation. Well, what is it? They can't even tell me. Oh, I just don't know. I just don't have the total. Well, if you don't have the total of it yet, it's probably not a revelation. It could be a schism in your mind. Because when God gives a revelation along with it, He knows that man is quite different of a created being than God Himself, which is spirit. He understands the intellect of man and its levels. So He's going to give you insight through the door of the Word so that it makes sense and you can share it, change your life with it, and share it with someone else, and it helps them. If you have to sit here and go, well, you know, it takes you 30 minutes to try to articulate one little insight of a passage, keep it. Amen? Keep it. Maybe we could just say it like this. That revelation is a palm tree. It needs to be silent for about 5 years. And in 1 year, bam, it grows. Amen? So here we see a door of the Word. Now watch this. To speak the mystery of Christ, for which also I have been bound. Look at that. So when this door of Word opened up to Paul, and when it would happen, it was for him to articulate the mystery of Christ, which was God coming, birthed through a virgin, into a human man body that was all man and all God. And he could articulate it because of this door of the Word opening so that people's lives were changed. It made sense to them, and they said, yes, I want Jesus. Does that make sense? Amen. So watch this. Paul understood that I need to understand the door of the word so I can share the mysteries of Christ to help people come into the kingdom. And he said, I have been bound by this, or this is my preeminent purpose. This is what I'm all about right here. This is my preeminent purpose. He wasn't the one that would share 10 keys to success, 10 keys to prosperity, 5 keys to get somebody healed. No, his primary purpose was to connect people to the mystery of Jesus Christ. And that was a great, great endeavor. And because of his being bound to this and ascribing to this very purpose, you and I have the New Testament. We have the history of churches being built all over and many, many lives changed by the thousands. Amen? Incredible work. Put this in your notes. God will grace you for the objective. That's supernatural. God will grace you for the objective. That's supernatural. See, super is God's super. God is supernatural. He's a supernatural being. He's a spirit. Do you hear me? His world, there is no time zone. His world, there is no sickness and disease. If God didn't create it, you don't need it. Put that in your notes. Some people say, well, you know, I got this thing. No, you don't. It did not come from God. Hello. It comes from a different spirit that just called to seek, to kill, steal, and destroy. A destructive spirit, and that's Satan. It didn't come from God. Even in modern day science, we understand that when a person gives themselves to stress and anxieties, their body becomes susceptible to sickness and disease, right? Because the body is not strong. The immune system is not strong to ward off different germs and bacteria. Does that make sense? And that can be a ploy of the enemy, a scheme or a scam, just to get us distressed, caught up in pressure and stress, and then, therefore, we open the door for him to plunder us. God does not give us sickness and disease. God is the healer of all sickness and disease. Amen? Acts 14, verse 19. So I've talked to you now about the door of faith. I've talked to you about the door of the word. Two doors that every believer needs to knock on and walk through. Now watch this. While Paul was receiving this door of faith, like many of us, he was facing some of the greatest opposition and persecution. Do you hear me? When you are being persecuted, when you're facing opposition, when you're walking through the pains of daily living, please remember there's a great breakthrough on the other side. There's a greater door that you're going to walk through. See, some would say God can use anything. He can. It's probably not his preferred method, but you can learn from anything. His preferred method is for us to read the word and go, yeah, that makes sense, doing that now. But some of us don't learn that way. So the enemy gives us a road of hard knocks. And God has to work with that to still bring us back to a point where he gives us understanding and revelation in his word. And to live according to the word and be obedient and willing. Do you hear me? So as Paul's pursuing the purpose for his life and to share the gospel of Christ to many people in the establishing of the early church, he encountered a lot of opposition. Before this door of faith opened to him, look at what he went through. Acts 14, 19. And Jews from Antioch and Iconium came there, who having persuaded the people and having stoned Paul, they threw him down out of the city, supposing him to have died. Do you see that? Verse 20. But the disciples surrounded him. Let me tell you, one of the number one things disciples do is camaraderie. Surround. Protect. Help. Bring healing. Bring comfort. Bring protection. And these disciples of Christ surrounded Paul. The people that had done this to him, the Jews of Antioch, thought that he was dead. They stoned him. They stoned him. And then they carried his body outside of town on a cart, one scholar says, and they dumped them off in the place where you would dump off bodies or things of discard. They supposed that he was dead. Now, Paul just didn't jump up. Look at the text. And the Jews from Antioch and Iconium came there. Is that right? Iconium? Came there, who, having persuaded the people and having stoned Paul, they drew him out of the city, supposing him to have died. Watch, verse 20. But the disciples surrounding him, he rose up. Notice he didn't rise up until after he was surrounded by the disciples. I think that's significant. I think that shows the camaraderie that should be in the body of Christ, and certainly amongst leadership. Do you hear me? It goes on to say, and he came into the city. He went right back where he'd gotten stoned. He went right back to the very people that had casted him out as a dead corpse. Now, he didn't stay there. Here's wisdom. When you've been thrown out of a place, don't think you need to hang out to change it. Write that in your notes. I can't tell you how many people that are sitting in dead, used up churches going, well, God just told me to sit here and be faithful or just stand and I'm going to change the pastor. Wrong. Not going to happen. Better off to just go to a place where there's life and living water and the living teaching of the word and there's life realized and get involved there because that's where your faith will be most effective. Do you hear me? Do you hear me right now? Paul didn't go back to Antioch and go, it's time for them to have a massive revival. It's time for me to change the situation. It's time for me to go in there and share the kingdom of heaven with them. Oh, no. He went, I'm going to the port. I'm getting on Princess Cruise Line. I'm out of here, Jack. Right? Verse 20. And the next day, he departed with Barnabas to Derbe. The next day. See, sometimes we convince ourselves to stay in a bad situation. We convince ourselves, not God convincing us. Sometimes when we're in a dilemma, we like to hear our own voice instead of his voice. Because his voice is saying, I'm leading you out, and it's going to require you to change something. And it's easier just to stay in the dilemma. Put this in your notes. Carnal people always think. Now watch this. The end part of that is, they determine your fate. No, God does. The carnal people of Antioch, I believe God wanted to bring them an incredible revival and restore to them the kingdom of heaven. I really do, through Jesus Christ. They stone the messenger. The messenger moves on. Their carnal minds thought that we have determined the fate of this man called Paul. That's the height of pride. Can I tell you, you don't determine the fate of anybody, only you. Only you for you. God will make a way whether you're in agreement with it or not. I've had people tell me to my face, you know what? Yeah, because I'm not involved. Yeah, blah, blah, blah. I always say, where are they? I've got a huge where are they list. And it seems like years after you, all of a sudden I encounter them and they're washed up, gone, busted, and broken, disgusted. And the only thing that changed was their belly and they got uglier. Belly got bigger, they got uglier. Seriously, nothing changed. See, so we've got to be a people in a constant state of change. Metamorphosis, always growing, always taking on a greater understanding or better understanding or a more defined understanding. Do you hear me? Always growing to fit our future. Does that make sense? So carnal people are always thinking, but carnal people are never doing. Put this in your notes. Disciples surrounded Paul and brought hope to him. That's what happened in that circle. Surround their brother. He had just been stoned. They thought, literally, the people that dumped him off thought he was dead. They surrounded him. I believe they probably surrounded him and started to pray. They probably started to encourage. They probably started to speak to that body that was beaten. And all of a sudden, that body, Paul, got a hold of hope. and his hope helped him up. Hear me right now. There may be a place that you get to where you feel like you've been so stoned or rejected or beaten by people. And you know what? You feel left for dead. Good news is, get around people of hope and you'll raise up soon. Amen? I prayed for a dead man the other day. You know what I spoke to? His hope. That one didn't come back to life. He got on the other side, went, "Sorry, Pastor, I'm not coming back." It's like, all right. Oh, well. At least I tried. Amen? I always said this, God, whenever he told me to lay my hands on people and pray for healing, I went, "Lord, you said it, I'll do it. Even if 1,000 drop dead, I'll still pray for people to be healed." And then whenever he said, "Go raise this person from the dead," and I did, I said, "God, as long as you tell me and send me, if they don't ever come back, I'll still do it because you said. And that one that does, hallelujah. The rest of them are probably in heaven laughing, slapping everybody a high five, saying, we're just so stubborn, we're not going back into that dead body. We're not going to listen to you." Amen? That's not a bad deal. Man, can you imagine stepping through the door into heaven? I don't know if I'd want to come back. So Drop and I have this agreement. Like if I'm under 80, yes, get it on. If I'm like over 85, leave me be. Amen? Praise Jesus. Put this in your notes. Your greatest doors open sometimes after your darkest defeats. Put that in your notes. Your greatest doors will open after your darkest defeats. By the way, I'd like to welcome all of you that are watching through Facebook. God bless you. Just give us a like right there or a comment. We want to hear from you. And certainly share this with your friends on Facebook and all the different social media outlets. You have access and the rights to do that. So take your right on our behalf. Put this in your notes. When the door of faith is assigned, nothing can malign it or misalign your path. When the door of faith is assigned, nothing can misalign your path to it. The devil will try, but if you keep listening to the voice of the Holy Spirit, you will walk through that door. Nothing will stop it. Nothing. Amen? And I'm telling you, trust me, it is uncomfortable to step out in faith. It's uncomfortable to call those things that be not as though they were. It's uncomfortable to go contrary to the opinions of some people. It is very difficult and challenging. We all like to be liked. And sometimes you won't for the gospel's sake. But it's a necessity. Amen? And God will grace you in that time. Look at what 1 Corinthians 16:9 says. This is Paul again. "For a great and effective door." Look at this door. This is a different door. So we've talked about the door of faith. We talked about the door of the word. Now we're talking about an effective door. "Has opened to me, and many are opposing." When you find an effective door, understand there may be some spiritual warfare. There may be some carnal warfare. People just led by their carnal flesh. But the thing you and I must do is give ourselves to the voice of the Lord and understand the objective at hand. That's the moment in time where you better zero in and know clearly the voice of the Lord and what he wants you to accomplish. And then along with the objective, you've got to know the time frame. And that's where we get that great and awesome song from the 80s by The Clash. "Should I stay or should I go now?" Right? You've got to be able to determine that. And sometimes it has to happen in the moment. See, many people, after they've had a great meeting and people got healed and it was great, people got saved and everybody's happy, they want to hang out with them. Sometimes that's not the time to hang out. That's the time to get up and get out. Hello? And get gone. Because you never want to be around a group of people that you do not know when the grace of God lifts off or the anointing of God lifts off your life. Put that in your notes. You may need that one in your future. Men, let me put it to you like this. If you've been in a meeting, the anointing's on you, the grace of God's there, you could bite the head off a rattlesnake. I got it. You know, things are moving and grooving. But you better have some good men around you and your wife, somebody that's very trusted. When that anointing lifts off of you and that grace is off of you, for that service, they can take care of you and get you to a safe place. Because it's in those moments many men and women of God have blown it or become susceptible to the devices of the devil. Amen? In foreign countries, and now I'm speaking to those that live overseas, to where you're dealing with opposing religions and opinions and thought processes, where your very life is at stake. You better go in, establish the work that God wants for you or for the people, and then get out of there quick. Do you hear me? Because your life weighs in the balance. See, here in America, we can just casually come in and go out. It's not that way in places overseas, certain places. You need to know when to get in and when to get out. I don't know why I'm saying that. It's very strong on my heart for somebody listening and tuning in. Look at this. Put this in your notes. There are always a few bees and bears around the honey. Put that in your notes. We're always driven by the honey. It's so sweet. Look what God's doing. It's so precious. It's so sweet. Never forget, around the sweet honey, there's always a few bees and a few bears. Amen? So get in and get out. Look at this. Put this in your notes. Faithful, relentless pursuit always pays great rewards. And Paul was good about this. Paul knew how to get in, get the work done, and move on. Amen? Sometimes our flesh wants to just hang with people that want to celebrate us. And there's a time for that. But when you're establishing some things, when you're trying to break up a territory, when you're trying to go in and plant something, especially when you're overseas, you've got to use a lot of wisdom. You've got to have that ability to discern what God's Spirit is saying to you. Paul, because of that, came into some rewards for his faithful service. The door of faith that you'll walk through on the other side will have reward. What's a reward? It's something that you did work towards and you are blessed with. It's given to you. I'm going to say it one more time. You're blessed with. It's given to you. Assigned to you. Ascribed to you. Put it to you like this. Maybe you went in to help in a church or a revival meeting or have a campaign or a crusade, and then all of a sudden just television just opened to you. You didn't anticipate that, didn't plan for it. Or maybe the radio network interviews you, didn't plan for it. Or maybe you go and you're at a meeting with somebody and you're there to help, and all of a sudden you find favor with somebody that's a decision maker, somebody that can help you. You've heard me teach about the butler, right? You run into a butler. This is happening with my kids. They meet somebody, share what they're about and who they are, and in just casual dialogue. And before you know it, that person says, I know somebody you need to meet. Let me call them. This is what they do. A door they could spend years trying to get through or knock down. And in a moment, one phone call. Reward. Reward. Look at this. We're almost done. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12. And when I came to Troas to preach Christ's gospel, and a door was opened to me by the Lord. Look at that door. I showed you another door. That's four doors I've showed you today. This is a door of the Lord. This door is effortless. Can you have a door for this? A door of faith for this one? Can somebody bring me that cup of coffee right there? Thank you. Now that was effortless, wasn't it? See? Do you see how that worked? I had a desire. All I did was make it known. Do you want it back? I want some bubble gum now. No, I'm teasing. Do you see how simple that was? Now, did I have to pray and fast? All I did was be obedient in the work of the Lord, walking out what he's asked me to do, and I make it available and known. Assignment. Diana, that's for you. That is for you. Grab it. In the walking it out, a phone call's made. In the walking it out, capital is received. I said at lunch with the other day, or coffee, my wife and I, man made his request known. God put this man in our life. We know it. He doesn't. As soon as he said it, my wife said, I've got that money. We'll do that business venture. Pretty good deal. We're going to make about 75% on our money. Do you hear me? This is what's going to happen to you. I'm going to prophesy. You're going to walk into people that have capital, and when they hear your vision because they like you, the reward will come effortlessly. And along with it, my wife says, let me help you understand this. We don't work. You do. But you will report to us, and this is what we want. Turn on our money. How would you like to have that return every 3 to 4 weeks? That's what God put on our family. Effortless. Why? Reward. Reward. And you know what? Here's what gets my mind. When it's anointed, they're blessed also. And they're getting more than what they were wanting. Amen? Everyone's blessed. And this is what Paul experienced, him and Barnabas. They had had trouble. They've stepped into a region, had success now, and now Paul's continuing on in Corinth. And look, and when I came here to preach Christ's gospel, a door was opened to me by the Lord. By the Lord. Sometimes those doors aren't in the church. They're at Starbucks, at Denny's, Applebee's, BJ's, wherever else people congregate. And you may never find those doors if you don't ever change your course. Sometimes we get so busy going to Save Mart, Walmart. Somebody forgets about, what is it, Lassen's, the other place, Whole Foods. Maybe sometime you just need to go over to that Hispanic market over there. I forget that. That's fun to go in. They got freaking things hanging from the ceiling over there, piñatas. You know, I stopped in a Hmong store the other day. Yeah. You never know who you're going to meet. But if we never change the course, we'll never experience a new door. This is good teaching. Look at this. This door is effortless. It was prearranged by Christ himself. Wow, I want those doors. I want those doors. We often say, man, if I could just have the attention of heaven, if you could find that door that Christ's open, wow, all of heaven's attention will be on you. Paul didn't have to rely on the people for this door. Look at it. God did it. How nice would that be? That would be awesome, wouldn't it? You know? Wouldn't it be nice if all the people call in sick one day and the Lord just opened a door. Whole new crew just walked in and got the job done. Wouldn't that be awesome? It's possible. Look at this. This took, remember, years of sowing. Hardship, you thought, was just a bad memory. God says, qualification. Working hard, the toiling with your hands, up at night, all night. Sometimes working till you have no more strength left. God says, that's a qualification. Enduring, how are we going to make it? It seems like everything we do doesn't turn out for our best interest. It seems like I've got a bag with holes in it. Seems like even though I'm rubbing sticks together, I have a lot of smoke but never get any fire. And God says, qualification for enduring. What can you endure to inherit all? Let me ask that. What can you endure to inherit all? I often think of my son, the countless hours every week he endures, the lack of favor with people that he endures, the things that he's told and never come about, people that promise him the moon and he never sees them again, them that are around him taking advantage of him, trying to figure out however they can get into his pocket. All for the sake of his passion. But he that endures to the end will receive the reward for faithfulness. Amen? Years of sowing, working, enduring. It's the qualification, and then reward comes. Look at Revelations. Here, our last passage. Revelation 3, 7. The Church of Philadelphia. Is this good? Feel like you've been to church? Feel like you had a door of faith open to you? A door of the Word? A door of the Lord? I'm about ready for a door of a sandwich box to open. And the door of a big feast opened to Pastor Goodman. No. Revelations 3:7. Look at this. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, he who is holy, he who is true, he who has the key of David, circle that, he who opens and no one shuts, and shuts and no one opens, say these things. Notice the key of David. What was the key of David? There were several. One, he tended his dad's sheep. He was a worker. He wanted to provide for the family through the herd. Watch. He was anointed by the prophet when he came to town that he was the one that was to reign over the nation of Israel. He received an assignment. Notice this. David also waited until the appropriate time. He was obedient and willing, but also abased. Watch this. The key to David was that he was a man that really desired to know God's heart and be like it. And because of that, when he was given forgiveness, it was accounted to him as righteousness. Right? Now watch. David was a ruler of much, but the ruling of much never superseded the worshiping of much, of God. Not stuff, but God. Because of his nature to worship, he had a key that others didn't have. And that key unlocked doors of favor with God. Now, out of his lineage, he was blessed that out of his lineage would come the Messiah. And that's the key you and I have today. And that key unlocks doors. That key unlocks eternity. That key gives access to you in heaven. Does that make sense? And all that God has becomes available because of the key of David, which is Jesus Christ, that this angel is speaking of. Look at this. He who opens and no one shuts, and shuts and no one opens, say these things. Verse 8. I know your works. Behold, I have given before you an open door, and no one can shut it. Look at that, the power of the anointed one and his anointing. For you have little strength. And I like that because the Bible says when we are weak, he's strong. Amen. We don't want self-strength, we want his strength. It's not bad to be strong yourself, but rely on his strength always. Look at this. And it goes on to say, you have little strength and have kept my word and have not denied my name. Because of that, this church had the key of David working for them, the Messiah, the door of the Lord. Close your Bibles.